Vishal sir, is there any problem?
So I guess he got disconnected.
Yeah, I think so.
Please, admin, please ask him to rejoin.
Okay, okay. Yeah. I will ask him. Hello, sir.
Sir, am I audible?
Yeah, Professor, you are audible.
Yes, sir, you are audible, sir.
Okay. So I was talking about the start of a regression. So basically, in case of a regression modeling, we are usually trying to predict the dependent variable with the help of few certain independent variable. Whenever one independent variable is there in the model, then we are talking about simple linear regression. But whenever there are multiple independent variables to predict about the dependent variable, we are talking about multiple regression. So the first question arises, why do we need and why should we go for this regression modeling, be it a simple regression or be it a multiple regression? The answer lies in itself. That is, around us, we usually find what people are doing. People are in the habit of predicting certain variables based on their intuitions, based on their own logic. But incidentally, what they are doing, they are applying this regression, whether they know the methodology or not. Let me take an example for the same.
Excuse me, Professor.
Yes, yes.
PPT is not visible. You have been minimized. So better you maximize that PPT. Yeah, now it is back.
Okay. No, I'll come to PPT later on. First of all, as I was taking the introduction, that's why I kept that minimized. Anyway, so in the usual day-to-day, how we can encounter this regression modeling, let me take an example. If somebody is predicting about Kisan Andolan, so many dynamics and so many variables are there with which people are talking about this Kisan Andolan. If you talk about weather, what would be the steepness of cold? What would be weather in May? So what we are trying to do, we are trying to see and forecasting or predicting the weather based on certain variables. So what other environmental variables are there which are impacting on the temperature? Based on that, I could logically talk about the weather could be ranged into this temperature to this temperature. People are forecasting about rain. People are forecasting about stock markets. They are talking about interest rate, monetary policies, and all these things. So incidentally or accidentally, they are applying certain logic, and that logic is nothing but the independent variables. So based on that independent variables, if somebody or any researcher or analyst could able to predict about the dependent variable or the variable which we are willing to forecast or predict, then we are into regression frame. We are into that modeling. Okay. For regression modeling, as you know, dependent variable is the one which we are willing to predict or explain. Independent variables are the variables which decides or explanatory. These are explanatory to this dependent variable. Whenever we are talking about one single independent variable in the frame, then we are talking about simple linear regression. And whenever some n number of independent variables are deciding or explaining or predicting the dependent variable, then we are into multiple regression frame. Right? Now, for ascertaining any regression model, the most important aspect is correlation. So I'm not taking much about the correlation, but correlation is, you can say that as an index. That is basically being decided by covariance. If two variables are moving together with their own variances, and some part of their variance is being intersected, it means covariance. So basically, this index, which we are calling as coefficient of correlation, small r, this is nothing but it is the ratio of covariances to variance. Now you can take it to standard deviation and all, but basically in the GIST, that's a ratio. And based on that, we are doing the indexation of this correlation, right? Then this correlation is having a property of ranging between -1 to +1. I'm talking about Carl Pearson's coefficient of correlation. So I'm not talking about rank correlation and all, although those are also falling in the same periphery, and those are mean for non-parametric correlations. But I'm talking thoroughly about this small r, which is Carl Pearson's coefficient of correlation. So it is ranging between -1 and +1. We cannot even imagine about regression without the presence of this correlation. If variables are little or no attachment with each other, they cannot develop any sort of causality. Causality could be negative, could be positive. If you take example of price and quantity, it's an inverse relationship, and that's why we'll find negative coefficients if we will go for regression modeling. If you talk about harvesting of rice crop and rainfall, you will find a direct proportionality or positive correlation between these two variables. And therefore, after causality, you will keep one as dependent, one as independent. So here, correlation is not the one which talks about prediction or which talks about causality. It's a shear, a relationship builder tool, you can say. It means what? Here, whenever I'm taking an array or data of rainfall, and whenever I'm taking the data of harvest of a crop, these two are not causing each other with reference to correlation. Are you getting my point? But as because they have some sort of relationship, and it says that crop is, harvest is gaining momentum with reference to rainfall in centimeter. It means I am talking, if with reference to regression, then I will say, let's have rainfall in centimeter as a independent variable and harvest in quintals or tons, that is a dependent variable. Okay. So the basic understanding close like this: there should be correlation amongst the variables which are participating. If variables don't have correlation, if they possess no association, in that circumstance, there is a problem. Okay. Next thing is variance. What exactly is variance? Variance is variability. So I will be starting my session with these variables. Will you able to see an Excel file? Okay. So here,
yes,
okay. So let's take this bar. So I would be demonstrating now the simple linear regression and multiple regression with all these hypotheses which are attached with it. Say this is a variable named as bars. Okay. Now what I'm doing is I'm going to this insert and let me draw a line chart. Okay. Let me have a line chart of this. This is a line chart of this variable bar. Okay. Right? What you are observing into this, for the sake of understanding, let me go to data. In the data, you will find this data analysis. If you are not finding this data analysis, what you can do is you can go to file, then you can go to options, you can go to add-ins. In the add-ins, this analysis tool pack is there. Click Excel add-in, go, and you will find this template. So you are required to put a check for analysis tool pack. The moment you will put a check, then okay, you will find this data analysis. So in the data analysis, if I go, I'll simply click this regression. And once I click okay, it is asking about these inputs. Input Y range. So Excel understand input Y range as a default dependent variable. So I'll click this and let me select this from the cell 1. Okay, I have selected this. Next, input X range. This is a default independent variable, and I am selecting only one, that is price. Right. Afterwards, I'm checking this box labels because I have included the names, confidence interval. That's it. Later things, at a later stage, we will take these residuals and all. So what I'm doing is, I'll simply requiring my output here in this cell. And okay, so this is my regression output. Okay, and this regression output is talking something, and based on this, we can predict. Now the concern arises, let me change my variable bars like this. Okay, all variables are like this, and you can see it's a straight line now. Let me undo this. You could see the graph is like this, and afterwards I have clicked, and now it's a straight line. Next to it, let me repeat this regression process. This is dependent. This is independent price one, and on the same. Here, at this point, let me go. Okay. So this is a regression output. You can very well see the difference between these two. Here multiple R or R square is 0.54. Here it is one. Multiple R is this. Here multiple R is one. Adjusted is here one, something else. 34 observations are there. And you could very well see there is the fetched data, which talks about sum of squared, mean sum of square, F statistics, and its significance. Things are not coming. And here, all is zero. Some are unable to be calculated by Excel. So what exactly has happened? What is the reason behind it? Why it is not fetching us the result for regression? What exactly is the reason? Reason is one. You could predict the or explain the variable based on its variability. If there is no variability, and if the dependent variable is constant, there is no meaning in predicting. Hame regression karne ki zarurat hi nahi hai. There is no meaning in going out for regression modeling. So some sort of variance is required for dependent variable. This is the first and prima facie thing to start with. So first thing is what? First thing is variability of dependent variable. If there is no variance in the dependent variable, all exercise which we are carrying is of no use. Okay. So let me resume this again. The data. So this is first thing. Now coming to second one. Second thing is, let's talk about deviation and dependent variable first. Okay. Let me clean this first. Okay. So if I wish to see the various aspects of my dependent variable for the study to be undertaken for this, then what I'll do is, let me compute different parameters which are associated with these dependent variable. So what I can do is, let me compute average of the same by applying the formula average I have applied the formula average for my dependent variable. Done. So this is the average. Let me also see the sum total of this by applying the formula sum. This is the sum. Now, what I can do is, let me take these two things a little away from the little away from this dependent variable. Now, can we compute deviations which are associated with this? Then the answer is yes. How can we compute the deviations? Deviation from mean. Basically, we are talking about computation of these deviations from mean. So x minus x bar. So x minus, this is average, so x bar. Let me log this. I have logged it, and now these are the deviations. Some are positive, some are negative. Okay. Some are positive and some are negative. So if I'll compute the average of this, it would be nearing to zero. At the same time, if I'll compute the sum total of this, again, this is zero. 4.01 E minus 13, it indicates that 4.01 multiplied by 10 to the power minus 13. So you can say that 0.12 zeros, and then the 13th term will be 4. So this is near, this is almost a zero. These are deviations. Now, if we will do deviation square, so let me compute the squared deviations, and squared deviations are this into this. So these are squared deviations. And again, let me compute the average of the same. And similar to this, let me compute the total. Okay. This is sum total. And this is the average. You could very well see what we have done so far is, we have first computed the average of this array. After computation of this array, what we have done, we have computed the deviations from the mean. After computation of this mean, it is clearly indicating average as negative, average as zero, and total as zero. Afterwards, what we have done is, we have computed the squared deviations, and these are the squared deviations. Okay. This is the average and this is the total. So basically, we would be requiring this number. We would be requiring this number. Kindly note this number in your cognizance. Okay. So these are deviations in dependent variable. Now, how these could be explained by this price? Let me take one variable first, and then we will go for two variable. So how it could be possible that this price will explain these variabilities which are there in the dependent variable? This is possible by applying the same regression which I have applied, this one. So after the application of this, we got something. We got these numbers, all these numbers, but everybody is simply putting variables into machine and some output is there, and they are simply talking about these outputs. From where these outputs have arrived, what is the logic behind it? So first let me explain that fastly, and then we will move forward. This much of variance is there, right? This much of variance is there. Is it possible by this single independent variable to explain this full variance? Let us see. So we have applied this regression. So looking into this regression, will you able to say, or will you be able to predict that it has explained something? Just see here. This is multiple R, this is R square, this is adjusted R square, these are standard errors, and blah, blah, blah. All these things are there. The concern arises, where from I get this number? So it's not possible to have a 100% explanation by any regression model, whether there are one independent variable involved, or two independent variable involved, or three independent variable involved, or some multiple. It's hypothetical. Just manipulating the data, it could be possible to have R square value as one. It is possible to have R square value as one. If R square value is one, in that given circumstances, this full variance is being explained by this price. But here, looking into this data, we could say that only 54%, 54.044, so let me call 54% of variance in the dependent variable is being explained by price, which is independent. So let me repeat once more for your understanding. This R square is nothing, but it is talking about explanatory power of the model. If it is 54%, then I must say that the variability which is occurring in independent variable is able to explain the variability in dependent variable by 54%. That's it. So predictability require more number of independent variables to reach to say 70% or 80%. Now the concern arises, how much should be R square? There is no set rules, and it is variegating from discipline to discipline. Had it been a matter of psychology, even a 15% explained variance will suffice the purpose. Or if it's a matter of medical accuracy, or some pharma sort of thing, or some drug case is there, then we must be requiring R square even above 99. So again, it is variegating from discipline to discipline. So I recommend better one should refer to literature review and looking into those accustomed and routine R square values. They could estimate the approximate aspect for the same. Okay. Now, this is the current status. Now, let me predict this manually. So how could I predict this? So I hope you all are aware about this equation. This one. This is dependent variable. This is population y-intercept. This is population slope coefficient. This is independent variable, and this is random error component. So this random error component is the residual, and it is the one which is not being explained. Still, there are more number of variables to be incorporated to have the explanatory power of the model on the higher side. Okay. This is simple linear regression equation, which provides an estimate of the population regression line. So this is y hat is equal to b0 plus b1x. This b0 is nothing but it is intercept, and b1 is nothing but it is the slope of the equation. Yes, this one. So I was talking about this. This is what? This is least square method. What basically is least square method? A method with which we are trying to minimize the errors. What we are trying? We are trying to minimize the errors. What exactly are the errors? Errors are the actual observations which are there for the dependent variable and the predicted dependent variable. So if my actual values and predicted values have some difference, and if that difference is on the higher side, let's say for a higher magnitude, it's nothing but this is the least square. So in the graphical mode, let us go to this. This So these blue dots are actuals, and this red line is the predicted one. So the difference between these blue dots and the point which is there on this line, that difference is residual. That difference is known as the difference between actual observations of the dependent and predicted observations, or you can say that predicted values of the dependent variable after regression. So this difference, if I could able to minimize overall this difference, so I could frame this line a little bit tilted, I could elevate it, I could in whatever fashion I consider this as a deemed fit, I can draw this line. So the process with which these differences could be minimized is known as least square method. Okay. So in your grad classes, you must have seen summation y is equal to na plus b summation x, and summation xy is equal to a summation x plus b summation x square. And whenever we are finding the values of a and b from these two linear equations, that a and b is nothing but that is intercept or beta. This intercept and beta is what? This intercept and beta are the parameters of regression. These are what? These are the parameters of regression. Up to this point, is it clear to all? If you have any doubt, any query, kindly ask. Okay.
Sir?
Kindly mute your mic, please.
Sir, I have a doubt.
Yes, please.
If the input and output data are known, then only we can able to do...
Just a minute. Masthani J, kindly mute your mic. Masthani J, kindly requested to mute your mic. Now, ask your query, please.
Sir, if the input and output values are known, then only we can draw simple linear regression. Otherwise, it is not possible. Am I correct?
Not exactly.
Hmm.
Come once again. Say it once again.
If the input as well as output values are known for a particular data sheet, then only we can able to draw simple linear regression. Am I correct?
Yes, you are correct. But despite knowing the input and output may be possible, you end up having the explained variance as 70% or 50%, whatever it may be.
Okay.
So given that circumstances, you need to explore from the literature review more variables, which could increase the explanatory power of the model. For example, you would say that Y is being caused by X. Okay.
Okay.
And you are saying that Y is being explained by X1. And this model yield some explanatory power, but need not necessary. If you will add one more explanatory variable, say X2, then it may increase the predictive power of the model. So it's an ongoing process. And sometimes we also end up having the redundant variables, which may or may not increase the predictive power. And thereafter, we are required to even take them out from the system as well. So I'll explain that. I'll explain the same.
Okay.
So I was talking about least square method. So in the same, here up to this point, I have come to deviation squares and I have concluded that this is the variance of the dependent variable. Now I have, by putting these things into machine, I got these two variables. I got these two coefficients. These coefficients are what? These coefficients are intercept and beta. This is the beta for the regression, and this is the constant for the regression. So what I'm doing is I'm taking as it is these two things. Okay, I'm taking these two values. This is alpha, or you can say that constant, and this is the beta. Beta is the slope. Okay, now what I'm doing is I'm trying to predict manually. Okay, what I'm trying is I'm trying to predict it manually. How it could be possible? Let's see. What is my equation? Y is equal to constant plus slope times the independent variable. So let me write. This is my alpha plus beta times my independent variable. So let me put this into one bracket and let me freeze the values of alpha and this beta. So I have freezed the value of alpha and beta. So this is my prediction. This is my prediction. And let me drag this. I have dragged it till the last. So these are my predictions, right? Okay. After these predictions, let me see the difference. Let me see the difference. Difference of what? Actual and predicted. So this is what? This is actual. This is what? This is predicted. This difference is nothing but residual. This is what? This is residual. So I'm coming back to this part, and let me go again to data, data analysis, regression. Everything is already set other than this. So let me take again this bar, then this price. I'm retaking this, the price, and let me have output here over this. I'm clicking residuals now. Okay. Also standardized residuals. Let's click OK. See here, 4166.23, 4166.23, and so on. And which value? 14th, sorry, not 14th value. After 12 counts, the value is 3031.954. So after 12 counts, 3031.95. So exactly same. You could match even the residuals, minus 25.2312. Minus 25.2312, and so on, right? So this difference is nothing but the residuals, and we are required to for these residuals. If these diagnostic for residuals are clear, it means various assumptions which are carried, like linearity, homoscedasticity, multicollinearity, autocorrelation. If all these are fitting well, then we are through. Otherwise, there is a problem in the model. Now, what I'm going to do is, let me take this prediction which I have done, or rather I should take this difference outside, because we are through of this difference. So let me put difference here and these two also here. Now, what I'm doing is, again, in the similar fashion and in the fast track, let me compute the average for this array. So I have computed average for this array. You can check, this is average for these predicted values. Now I'll do the same, deviation and deviation square. So I have computed deviations from this mean, right? And then the deviation square. And let me drag this till the last. So this is average, this is average, this is average. And similarly, these are what? These are the sum totals. Okay. Now, just look at this figure, 281,53,486, and here the number is 5209,3,677. This divided by this value, let us see what exactly is this. This value is 0.54044. See here, 0.54044. If I'll put how many digits are there, jitni bhi hain. So let me take this and simply click here. The same number. It is the same number. So the crux of the story is, with this way I could get r square. With this way I could get r square. So I think you are I'm hoping that you are understanding how we are reaching to this number of r square. First, we have computed the deviations from the mean for the dependent variable, and then its square, and the sum total is variance attached with this dependent variable. Now, after prediction with one single variable, for these predicted we have seen the same thing, and now comparing this and this, we got it is 54% approximately. So this 54%, this 54% we got from here. So this is the process. This is one. So the second thing is very clear: deviation in the dependent variable, which are being explained by independent. We have also seen normal equation. Normal equation is nothing but least square method. And if you would be asking what exactly this equation is, then this equation is, I repeat once more, summation y is equal to na plus b summation x. So summation y is what? The sum total of y. That is equal to n is the observation, so na, a is the intercept, plus beta times summation x. So summation x is the sum total of independent variable. This is first equation. Second equation is a summation x, sorry, summation xy means x into y and then their total. So summation xy is equal to a summation x plus b summation x square. So based on this, either you can write in the two equation form or simply this one. Both are giving and yielding the same result. So these are normal equations. Now, is it possible to have explanation for this? Is it possible? Yes, it has a significant explanation, and we can even compute this with a concept viewpoint. Just see what I am doing. Once we are through of it, regression would be very easy for us. This is squared sum, this is mean sum, this is f, and this is significance of f. So just look at this 281 53 486. This is the number. Just see this 281 53 486. So this is nothing but this number has come from this variance of the predicted, right? Now the concern arises, from where this residual have arrived. Just look at this 5209 3677. From where this come? 5209 3677. So this is the variability which is there in the dependent variable. Done. And the difference between, sorry, and the difference between these two, let me check this value, which is total variance of the dependent variable minus this is the predicted variance of the dependent variable. See, the numbers are same. What is this degree of freedom? How many regressors are there? Only one price. If independent variable is one, then degree of freedom in case of regression will be one. What are residuals remaining? Because sum total is 33. Why 33? If the total is 34, because n minus 1, degree of freedom is n minus 1. Just see, count is 34. total number of observations for this model is 34. So n minus 1 is degrees of freedom. So here total is taken as 33. Now residual is remaining. 32 plus 1 is 33. Now coming to this MS. What exactly is this MS? For mean sum of square, what should I do is, I'll simply go this way. This value divided by degrees of freedom. This value divided by degrees of freedom. You can see the value is same. If for the next, this value divided by degrees of freedom, the value will come like this. Let me take this here. Now you can see that these two values are matching with this. How we have arrived to mean sum of squares? This is nothing but SS divided by degrees of freedom. I have done this. This SS divided by 1, the same value. In the next case, 2394094091 divided by 32. So we yield this number. This is nothing. This is the ratio of these two. This divided by this. You can see 37.6317, same number. So let me take this here and let me take these two here, right? This is your F statistics. Now, again, this F statistics is what? This is significant. So if it is significant, it clearly says that at least among, because here only one predictor is there. So I must say that this predictor variable will yield some significant contribution in explaining this dependent variable. Had it been, if this is not rejected, say for example, and if it is insignificant, this is significant. Okay, why it is significant? If I'm considering 95% as my confidence or 5% as my test battery of alpha, then this value is lesser than 0.05. If it is lesser than 0.05, it is rejecting the null hypothesis. What is the null hypothesis? Null hypothesis is beta 0, beta 1, beta 3, all are equal and all are equal to 0. So what I'm trying to say here is at least one of the beta is there, which is non-zero. Okay, which is non-zero. I'm trying to prove this. If at least one of the beta is non-zero from the explanatory variable list, then there is a meaning of prediction. Otherwise, if all are zero, then this regression model is of no use. So I repeat, what I'm saying that if some good number of explanatory variables or regressors are there or independent variables are there, more than one, then it is talking about all. It is saying that maybe possible one is having a beta of zero, maybe possible second is also having a beta of zero, but maybe possible third is having some beta value which is non-zero. And therefore, this F statistics giving us a permission for going further. And now it depends on the discretion of that researcher that he should dig out the information for which variable is non-zero or significant and which are insignificant and having a value which is equal to zero. So I hope up to this point, is it clear? Moving to the next part. Next part is these coefficients and their standard error. So these coefficients are what? These coefficients are intercept and price, intercept and beta or slope. Afterwards, these are what? These are standard errors. What exactly is the meaning of standard error? standard error is, you can say that it's the hindrance to the prediction. Okay, if the standard error is too high, then it would lead to the problem of heteroscedasticity, and it would again lead to higher side t statistics value, maybe possible whatever p value we will get that is not up to the mark, maybe camouflage is there. So we should take these things very cautiously. And you might have gone through this for the standard error. You could understand this concept like there is a central limit theorem. What that central limit theorem says, it says that if some results are being generated for some population based on one sample or two sample or three sample or four sample, then authenticity could be adjusted. If 95 researchers will do the same thing, then results will have a mean range of this or fall into that confidence interval. The same thing I am talking about standard error. So it is what it is. It is some sort of thing which relates with the sample population kind of thing, but we should estimate it with caution because we shouldn't be entangled into problem of having a wrong t statistics or wrong p value. And therefore, how could we reach to this t value? T value we could reach if we will divide this coefficient with this standard error. You can see this is matching. Similarly, for the next one, next t statistics, the same thing is applicable. So here this coefficient means beta divided by standard error, we will fetch the t statistics. Now these are p values, and these p values are significant. Both are significant. Values are 0.000 up to 10 zeros are there, and 11th value is 1, and next one. Here 6 values are 0 and the next value is 73. So it clearly indicates that both intercept as well as beta for this regression is significant, and we can move forward for the further analysis. Clear? So this was a little blinking into or entering into regression modeling. It is a case of single regressor. And in case of a single regressor, we are calling this as a simple regression, simple linear regression. Had it been two, okay? So here itself, I am taking two now. What I am doing is, now I am putting this bar here. And let me conduct a multiple regression. So in the data analysis, regression, this is your dependent variable. Now I'll take these two together, and these two are independent variable. I would be requiring residual, standardized residual, and let me take the output here. Output here. It is K78, right? So this is your output for multiple regression. You can compare. Earlier, your R square was around 54. Now your R square is around 75. It means the second independent variable which has entered into this system or this model is enhancing the explanatory power of this model, and therefore it is worthy inclusion of this independent variable. Now fastly we can say here R square is confirming the same. I'll come to adjusted R square. Next, all these things are very clear to us, and F is significant. Now we can say that beta zero is equal to beta one is equal to beta two, means I'm talking about these three. Okay, so beta zero is equal to beta one is equal to beta two is equal to zero. Let us take this as my null hypothesis, which is rejected by F statistics, and it clearly says that at least one among these three is there, which is having some explanatory power for this regression model. But fortunately, all three, including the constant, all the two slopes are sufficiently significant in explaining the dependent variable, which are bars. Okay, so this is all about multiple regression. Now, whether it is a simple linear regression or multiple regression, but before going to assumptions, let me ask if anybody of you are having any query, kindly raise the query first, and then I'll move further for assumptions and further discussions. Any query? Okay.
Sir, we cannot hear you, sir.
Okay. So there are four assumptions. One is the linearity. Second is the independence of error, normality of error, and equal variance. So equal variance says that what? It is talking about homoscedasticity. And if unequal variance exists, then it creates the problem of heteroscedasticity. Normality of error says that whatever we have computed as a residuals have a distribution of normal, are normally distributed, means they possess a normal distribution. If they are possessing the normality, it means there is no problem and we can go further. Next is independence of error. Independence of error is talking about autocorrelation. So I'm talking about that. Let's say I have simply copied these residuals, okay? And after taking these residuals here, I took one lag. One lag means I left one period or one cell or one observation and then pasted the same values. Now, let me remove the last one from the second and first one from the first. and let me compute the correlation between these two. So I'm computing the correlation between these two arrays, between these two variables, and it is -0.16. It means there is hardly any problem if this correlation is going on the higher side. Then we can say that these are serially correlated, or these correlations are directional. Here, as such, there is no problem. And in the time series modeling also, these are falling under the category of AR models, that is autoregressive models. So let me take one by one. In the case of residuals, we have already seen actual minus predicted. So whatever is yielded, that is residuals, but those are error terms. So graphically, what is the problem of linearity? If we are getting residuals in such a way, if we are getting residuals in such way, then these are not linearly related. A U shape or elevated V shape, then we can say that residuals are not having linearity. But if they are fetching us such type of scatter plot, or they are bound under some planed bound, then they are showing some linearity. So this is the first assumption. Let us come to second one. Independence. So whenever we are talking about residuals are independent or not, they are falling under some bounds. For example, if I must say +3 to -3 in case of a normal distribution, so it's a bound. If I would say +2 to -2, they are falling under some bound. Here, which is not dependent, is showing some sort of a trend or some sort of curvilinear crest and troughs kind of a shape. We can check the normality with the help of box plots. Those are whisker box plots. We can use the histogram. We can apply the Sapiro-Wilk test or Lillifer or Anderson-Darling test, whatever is suitable to you. And we can also go for normal probability plot or quantile-quantile plots to check for the normality. Next is talking about homoscedasticity. In case of homoscedasticity and heteroscedasticity, if we are putting some trend line for the residuals, then just look at this first one. With increase in the values of x, or with x furthering high, this siphon is increasing. Okay, it means variance is increasing. And if the variance is increasing and variance is not constant across the board, it is a problem of heteroscedasticity. So wherever you find a non-constant variance, the problem of heteroscedasticity arises. And just look at these two figures. They are into some closed bound shell. So this is giving us a hint for constant variance. And now we can say that these are homoscedastic. Here we can say that the residuals are homoscedastic. Let me take a few more. Yes. Talking about autocorrelation. Autocorrelation could be ascertained with the help of Durbin-Watson statistics. What exactly is this? Used when the data are collected over time to detect if the autocorrelation is present in the residuals or not. autocorrelation exists if residual in one time period are related to residuals in the another time period. I have demonstrated the same. I took residuals and then the same residuals I took for the second lag period. So if a residual shows the cyclical pattern are a sign of positive autocorrelation. So what is the requirement? Requirement is these residuals should show no patterns, rather they should be randomly distributed across some line, and here the line is zero. So across this zero, they should hover around this randomly. If they are hovering randomly, it means there is no problem. But if they follow some pattern forming U shape or V shape, then they are trending. And if they are trending, it means these residuals are governed by their earlier values. So autocorrelation is a correlation of errors over time. And it violates the regression assumptions that residuals are random and independent. What is the hypothesis? Hypothesis is, null hypothesis is residuals are not correlated, whereas alternate is positive autocorrelation is present. So what are the ranges? The possible range is 0 to 4 if it is lying in this. D should be close to 2 if H0 is true. D is less than 2 may signal a positive autocorrelation, and D greater than 2 may be a negative autocorrelation. So we can say that if the Durbin-Watson statistics is falling near to 2, then it satisfies our assumption of no autocorrelation. But if it is moving on the higher side towards 4, it is breaching and it signals the positive autocorrelation. If it is moving towards 0, breaching 2, the level of 2 and moving towards 0, then it signals negative autocorrelation. Next is, say for example, here the Durbin-Watson statistics is 1.00494. So it is less than 2, but it is not approaching towards 0. So it is up to the researcher how he would consider this. Altogether, it is showing the signs of having the positive autocorrelation problem. Okay. Next is, okay, now I'm coming to the same thing. We haven't seen till now about interpretation of these coefficients. So how could we interpret about these coefficients? Should we say that one unit of a change in price will bring forth -53.217 unit of a change in the dependent variable? Or should I say that one unit of a change will bring forth 3.613 units of a change in the dependent variable? Then there is a problem. Why? Because price is measured in some unit of currency. Promotion is also measured, if it in currency, then fine. But if promotion is measured with some other subjective parameters, say it could be measured with the motivation of salesman, then there is a problem. So at times in the regression modeling, we encountered that these coefficients, particularly these coefficients, are unstandardized coefficients. These are unstandardized coefficients. And unstandardized coefficients cannot bring forth the comparability for these two. Means, which is the highest contributor cannot be decided by the magnitude of this number, because maybe possible price is different and promotion is different. If it is a case of metric data or continuous data, that's all fine. But if the second data is on a Likert scale or if it is an interval one, then in case of an interval data, which is say Likert scale data, then the data is restricted from 1 to 5 digits only, and they will yield a different kind of coefficient. So unstandardized coefficient, which is based on Likert and which is visible, just say price or promotion, these are not comparable. And that's the reason what is required is we need to convert these variables into Z values and then apply the regression. So if somebody would be asking how it is possible to convert all these values, it's very simple. Let us take these values. These are the values. And let me compute their standardized values. So I will call this as Z bars. I'll call this as Z price. And the next one, I'll call Z promotion. So there are various methods with which you can compute this standardized values. One method for computing is similar way. I'll compute the average first. And after computation of average for these variables, I'll compute the standard deviation. So I have computed average. This is the average and average for others. Next is standard deviation. So this is STDEV and standard deviation for these variable is this. So this is average, this is standard deviation. And now what I'll do, X minus X bar divided by standard deviation. So this is X minus, this is X bar. And let me lock this. So I have locked this X minus X bar. Let me put it in a bracket and then divide by the standard deviation. This is your standard deviation. Again, let me lock this value. This is the value which is required. Similarly, I could compute it for others as well. So these are Z values or standardized values. Okay. So let me compute for others as well. But here, this value is right, but let me change the values like this. So these are the Z values. Right. Similarly, for the third one, these are the Z values. One more way with which you can compute is simply put standardize. Okay, standardize may put this comma mean value is this, mean value is this, and it is talking about standard deviation. So again, the standard deviation is this. So just lock this and it's done. It will automatically compute the values. The values are same. So in this way, either by manual computation or by using the Excel inbuilt formula of standardize, you can compute the standard values. The concern arises why we have computed this, to compute the regression model. So I'll go back to my regression model. I'll take the dependent variable, and I'll take dependent variable as z bars. Now, what I'll do is, I'll take z price and z promotion as independent variable. I'll compute my results. Here. Same regression is there. You can see all values are same. If I've converted these values as a standardized values or Z values, you can compare. This is my result. If I'll put this near to, you can see multiple R is same, R square is same, adjusted R square is same. Standardized errors are same. All these are same. What is the difference? Difference is in the coefficients. Even this ANOVA table will be same. Let me copy this ANOVA table and let me take it downside. See here, 2, 31, 33, 25. No, it's different. It's different, okay. But these are standardized values. This is different. I'm talking about significance. Significance is same. It is zero and it is also zero. Now only the difference which is there is here in the coefficients. Now these coefficients and these coefficients, just check. There is a huge difference. But these coefficients are now comparable because these are unitless. These are unitless. And now I could say that whichever is higher, the impact of Z price is more in comparison to Z promotion. So more contribution is there, although it's negative, but more contribution is there from the Z price. It means price is the more contributory variable for regression model. In this way, we can compute all these things. Let me show it on SPSS so that you can see both the values which I have computed manually. I'll go to regression. In the regression, I'll go to linear. I'll take bars, price and promotion. In the statistics, I'll click estimates, confidence interval, model fit. Now collinearity diagnostics, Durbin-Watson. In the plots, let me take Z resid, that is residual, standardized residuals and standardized values for predicted. And I'm clicking histogram and normal probability plot. I wish to save unstandardized predicted values, standardized predicted values, residuals, unstandardized and standardized, Mahanalobis, Cook's distances, and leverage values, I wish. And options, it's all fine. Style is fine, no bootstrapping. So let me click, and it will give us the full-fledged discussion which we are requiring. See here. Durbin-Watson value is 2.282. So it is nearing to 2. It is not high and not approaching or very near to 3 or 4. So, and at the same time, if the value is say 1.8 or 1.9, that would be a satisfying value. So here the problem of autocorrelation is not there, right? This significance of F is 0.000. It means F statistics clearly indicates we can proceed further for modeling. And at least one of the regressor is there, which has non-zero slope. If I'll go individual, then in case of individual, you can see here, these are unstandardized coefficients. Based on this, these are the t values and their respective significances. Okay, so all these values are significant. It means this slope and this slope along with this constant all are significant and contributory to regression model. If I wish to compare it with the standardized beta, then I must say that 0.690 is having a higher magnitude in comparison to promotions. Now coming to this collinearity statistics, which is the only thing which is left, and this is talking about multicollinearity. What is multicollinearity? Multicollinearity is a problem when two independent variables which are explaining the dependent one are having high correlation. I repeat once more, if independent or explanatory variables have high correlation amongst each other, then the problem of multicollinearity arises. How could we judge whether multicollinearity exists or not? So we can judge multicollinearity with the help of these collinearity statistics. First is the tolerance, second is VIF. VIF is known as variance inflation factor. Three is the high side value, five is accommodable, and 10 is the highest one. If VIF is crossing 10, then there is a huge problem. If it is crossing 5 or if it is crossing 3, these are moderate disturbances and which could be corrected by centering the values. How could we center the values? Centering the values means for the whole data set, you compute mean and subtract mean out of those values and recalculate. Then you will find that this VIF is declining. What exactly is this tolerance? Tolerance is inversely proportional to variance inflation factor. And if the tolerance is having value greater than 0.20, then that is okay. But if the tolerance is lower than 0.2, there is a huge problem. Then again, there is a problem of multicollinearity. These collinearity diagnostics, if you will see the variance proportions, then just look at this constant, price and promotion. Only one value is there which is on the higher side, that is 0.98, only one value. If you look at this, these values, price, only one value is 0.90, rest all are below 10, below 0.10. Okay, third one is promotion, just look at this, it is 0.84 and the rest of the values are very low. If such situation exists, it means there is no multicollinearity. But if such situations are not existing, so with these two things, with the help of variance proportions and with the help of tolerance and VIF, we can predict about this. Now coming to residual statistics, just look at this Mahana Lobis distance and Cook's distance and content leverage value. What exactly these three values are talking? These values, if you look at, it is minimum 0.012, maximum is 3.744. So based on the degrees of freedom and your alpha level, you can decide for, let's say in my case, it is 7.38 based on this value. I'm not going much into that mathematics of Mahana Lobis distance, but there is a benchmark value. If in my case, say for example, it is 8, nearing to 8. So all values which are there in the data set, if those are lesser than 8, acceptable. If any of the value, any of the observation is greater than 8, we are required to consider that as an outlier. Same is the case with Crookes distance. It is talking about the impact of that observation and how much it is contributing impactfully in the observation list. So if the value is greater than 1.2, then we are required to revise that observation. I'm not saying revising means change the value. I'm saying that you need to go back to your data set and check whether the values are outliers or it is required to be taken out from the analysis. Same is the case with centered leverage values. The same is the case. Now, firstly, going to this chart, you can very well see that here the histogram is being covered by this normal Gaussian curve, and mostly all values, barring few, are outside. So, broadly, we can say that it is not having a problem of normality, and it is confirmed by normal PP plot, probability plot. You can also look forward for this QQ plot. This is quantile plot, and here all these dots or values are hovering around this line. They are not at a scattered, and they are not at a scattered levels, or they are not scattered significantly. So if these values are hovering around this line, clearly indicates it is normally, residuals are normally distributed. Now, for the case of homocetasticity, whether data is homocetastic or not, what we can do is we can add a reference. Let me take the position as zero. Okay, I took a reference here. You can very well see significant number of values are there on the upper side, significant number of values are there on the lower side, distances if you will see. So it indicates the constancy of the variance. Okay, so if the constancy of variance is there, it means what? It means the residuals are, or error terms are, homocetastic in nature, and data is not diseased with heterocetasticity problem. So we can very well go further. So I talked about assumptions, namely first thing, linearity. In case of linearity, you simply look forward for the scatter plot for variables, participating variables. Next thing, I talked about autocorrelation. So in case of autocorrelation, what we have seen, in case of autocorrelation, we have simply seen the Durbin-Watson statistics. So for a review purpose, if the Durbin-Watson statistics is exceeding 4, there is a huge problem. If it is exceeding 2, and if it is moving forward towards 4 and going on the higher side or nearing to 4, then we may end up having positive autocorrelation. If it is lesser than 2, and if it is approximating towards 0, then we may have negative correlation, negative autocorrelation. Next thing was multicollinearity. In case of a multicollinearity, I have explained, tolerance is inversely proportional to variance inflation factor. Variance inflation factors are benchmarked depending upon the type of research as 10. 10 is the highest one. This index shouldn't cross the 10, but people are even going up to 5 and 3. So if it is crossing 3, below 3, there is no problem. If it is crossing 3, there is a little bit of a problem. If it is crossing 5, there is a moderate problem. But if it is more than 10, there is a huge problem of multicollinearity. So accordingly, we can see that. Same, it is confirmed with the variance proportions. You will find only one variable with the high magnitude and density, and rest others are very low. In case of roots distance, it is talking about impactfulness or impact contribution of that observation which is there in the variable, and accordingly we will decide the fate of that observation as a outlier or else. Same is the case with Mahalanobis distance. Based on degrees and freedom, and there is a calculation method, we can decide for our model as some benchmark value, and all values should be lesser than that. So with this minimum and maximum, we can ascertain here the highest value in the data set for all observations is 3.7. Okay, so it's very clear to me. Centered leverage value, this is also used for the same purpose. I took about the normality of residuals by this bar chart and being overlapped by normal curve. and confirmation with the help of PP plot or QQ plot, which is clearly confirming as these values are hovering around this line. This is about heteroscedasticity. There is no problem of heteroscedasticity existing in the model as constancy of variance is there and scatter plot is bit random. So both the things could be ascertained. Even the autocorrelation, people are taking the cognizance of autocorrelation based on this diagram, and based on these randomness, they could say there is no problem of autocorrelation. So this is all about regression. And as I have marked for the checks, check boxes, this is Mahan-Lobis distance, this is Krug, and this is leveraged one. So we can identify. And there is a check method. Should I see one-to-one values? Answer is no. Here, my decision output is showing that value of Mahan-Lobis is 3.744. Okay. So is there any value which is higher than this? Answer is no, because it is already showing. But if I wish to put 2 as a or 2.5 as a value, then what should I do? So given that circumstances, we can go for select cases, and the whole data set would be selected based on that. Here the condition is this one, I need to find out the value which is, say, greater than. Okay. Greater than 2.5. And if I wish to exclude that, at the same time, I also include Cook's distance, then let me put this end and this value. And let me say higher than 1. Okay. Higher than 1 in the output. And then say continue. Okay, so this is my condition. Click OK. In the data set, see, these are the values. It has covered every such value. It has covered every such value. There is no problem. And these will fall under not selected. If the reverse would be there, accordingly, it will select values which are required. So we can filter based on our requirements. We can filter accordingly. So let me go back to this and select, analyze all the cases. Okay, so accordingly, we will select all the cases and proceed further. I hope you understood. If you have any query, kindly raise the query. Ajay sir, are you there?
Yes, sir, I am here.
So
I will request participants that if you have any question, you may please ask.
Sir, in the SPSS file, in the
yes.
left side, all the number, like the serial numbers, they were crossed. So what was the implication of that? I mean, this 1, 2, 3.
Okay. For example, looking into my output for these Mahan-Lobis distance and Krug's distance. Okay. Here already I am aware about minimum value and maximum value, right? So if I set a benchmark as 3, and if I wish to see how many values are there which are greater than 3. Okay, so it will select all the values bearing few. So whatever is the left outs, we can consider that as a outlier. You got my point?
Okay, sir.
It's a method of filtering. Simply as we are doing in the Excel, I'm simply filtering these values.
So sir, Mahan-Lobis distance, can't it be calculated in Excel?
It could be calculated, but it would take you know, its own time. You need to put some formulas and all.
Okay, okay, sir.
With the software,
is there in the data tab, we won't we get any formula for Mahalo resistance?
With the help of Visual Basic, you can do that. With the help of Visual Basic, you can do that.
Okay, sir.
Yes, more questions, please.
Any other question? So there is a question, sir, written by Farooq Khan. He is writing, sir, whether bubble chart also include regression analysis.
Yes, it includes. It includes, but that entirely depending upon what is the purpose of regression. For example, let me take one example. If there is high side multicollinearity, and if even after centering the data observations, you couldn't find any solution, then what you will do? Better don't go with simple linear regression. Better don't go with multiple linear regression or polynomial regression. The best solution is go for a ridge regression, RIDGE, ridge regression. So similar way, these bubble charts could be included in the regression analysis to find out the intersection for these standard errors. This is helpful. I hope, Farooqji, I am reaching to you. As because we are having a constraint of time, I have cut short the session, but otherwise there are, you know, anybody could speak about this regressions for months. Regression is discipline in itself. Farooqji has said that as per my understanding, when variables are more than two, then we go ahead with bubble chart. That is what I'm saying. In the case of multiple regression, and when you are required to find out the intersected one, means one circle, Venn diagram you have seen. So one circle, two circle, and three circle, and whatever is the commonalities, that intersected part. So usually I have seen, as per my understanding, the bubble charts are used. So whenever you are encountering with multiple regressors or multiple explanatory variables, bubble chart is useful. More questions, please. Yes.
Any other question from participants? So in that case, when there is no question, I will thank Professor Vishal Vyas for giving such a nice talk. And I think that most of the students got benefited from the talk. So thank you very much, Vishal sir. If you can you please share the slide with me?
Sure, sir. I will share the material which is there with me.
Hello.
Yes.
Yes. Abhijit, yeah.
I would request you to share your both the SPSS file, Excel file, and the PPT. And also, sir, please share your email ID at the chat box so that, if we face any problem regarding any formula in the Excel, or if we get stuck in any way, because like following your class, like we won't be able to grasp everything, but when we will practice, so we will get the better idea. And if we get stuck, so that we can contact you via email.
Sure. I will do that. I will share the PPT as well as Excel file and SPSS file with Professor Ajay, and then it will reach to you.
So please share your email ID also so that we can contact if we face any problem with the content.
Sure. My email ID is vishal@triitm.ac.in.
Can you please type in the chat box?
Yes, sir. Is there any other question? Any other suggestion? No. So thank you, Vishal sir, once again.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for calling me.
It's a privilege, sir. Very good session, and participant enjoyed a lot. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.